Excuse me.
I beg your pardon. Aren't you Guy Haines?
Oh, sure. I saw you blast Faraday right off the court in South Orange last season. Made the semifinals, didn't you?
Yeah.
Oh, I certainly admire people who do things. By the way, my name is Bruno. Bruno Anthony.
See?
Well, I suppose you think it's corny, but my mother gave it to me, so I have to wear it to please her.
How do you do?
I don't talk much. You go ahead and read.
Thanks.
Now, it must be pretty exciting to be so important.
Tennis player isn't so important.
Oh, but people who do things are important. Now, me, I never seem to do anything. I suppose you're going to Southampton for the doubles.
You are a tennis fan.
Gee, I wish I could be there to watch you. But I've got to get back to Washington tomorrow. I'm from Arlington, you know. Cigarette?
Not now, thanks. I don't smoke much.
Me, I smoke too much.
Oh, here.
Oh, thanks. Oh, elegant. From A to G. I'll bet I can guess who A is.
Yeah?
Ann Norton. You see, sometimes I turn the sports page and I see the society section. And the pictures. She's very beautiful. Senator Morton's daughter, huh?
You're quite a reader, Mr. Anthony.
Yes, I am. Ask me anything. I'll get the answer. Even news about people I don't know. Like, who would like to marry whom when his wife gets her divorce?
Perhaps you read too much.
Oh, there I go again.
Hello and welcome to Book vs. Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of ColoniaBook.com, and this is my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone.
Happy Pride.
Yes.
I'm enjoying, you know, in San Diego, we have extra long Pride because our celebration is actually in July, but June 1st,
yeah,
if not before. And sort of, yeah, sort of Memorial Day weekend's kind of the unofficial kickoff of Pride here in San Diego. Anyway, we have a really fascinating book and movie that we're going to talk about today. But before we get to that, if you are brand new, yeah, we talk about movies that have been adapted from books, but also from other literary sources, because we do a brand new episode every single week. It's not always easy to get to a 300-page book in a week sometimes. So we are always looking for suggestions. If you have a movie that has been adapted from a literary source, as long as it's easy for us to get our hands on, as long as the movie is streaming somewhere, because we want you to be able to see it too, that's really the only criterion. It needs to be adapted from a literary source and widely available. So if you have suggestions, if you want to meet at the listeners of this podcast or interact with us, there's a few places where you can do that on the internet.
Yes, we do a basic Facebook page. Be sure to like it. But if you want to interact with Margot and I, you need to join our Facebook group. And in the group, we always are giving out ideas. And we got a couple of really great ones, actually, in just in the past week. But Thaddeus, one of our top commenters, put up a note at the top post on Facebook. And it's given all the episodes that we've covered so far, like 95% sure, and then like a running list of ideas. So thank you, Thaddeus, but also just jump on there and just give us your ideas. And other places you can go are Twitter and Instagram, and at both of those places you spell out book versus and movie. And then we have an old-timey email, book versus movie podcast, spelled it all out, at gmail.com. Let us know your suggestions, or if you would like some stickers, we have some stickers available for you. We're happy to drop them in the mail wherever you are on the planet of Earth, because we're an international show.
That we are, and we welcome you and thank you for joining us here. If you really, really enjoy the show and would like to help keep us in books and movies, you can also support us on Patreon.
Yes, we've been doing the show. It's going to be going on 10 years, probably next year. I think we're in the middle of our ninth year. And so I've taken all the episodes from 2020. There's maybe a couple left, but all of them are behind the Patreon wall. We've been releasing them every Thursday. There's hundreds of episodes there, but just recently we put up Harold and Maude, His Girl Friday, Little Women's coming up, and also coming up, The Ghost of Mrs. Muir, The Perfect Storm, Stand By Me, The Phantom of the Opera, Turn of the Screw, and The Stepford Wives. They're all coming out on Patreon. They're not available anywhere else. So go to Patreon if you want to support us. And we really just use the money for the books and the movies and the podcasting host costs. So any of you that do that, we totally, totally appreciate it. But if money's tight or you have just too many subscriptions, we totally get it. If you could just leave us a review wherever you get your podcasts, that would be amazing.
Or tell somebody about the show. We love that. Thank you very much. Sorry, here in San Diego, there's like just sheets of pollen falling down. And
and in New York, I don't know if you saw the news, but we had smoke everywhere that came from Canada. Yeah. So, yeah, for 3 days, I couldn't really leave my place.
Yeah. Ugh. It's not a good summer for air quality, for sure. Let me start over again. For Pride Month, we have a really interesting author who we've talked about before, but we'll get a little bit more in-depth into her bio. And we also have a filmmaker we've talked about before extensively, even just recently, because we just recently did Rear Window, right?
Yes, we did.
But this is a movie that is often discussed in terms of its gay, what do we want to call it?
Subtext.
Overtones, subtext, which is very much on purpose. It's not that we are not reading it in, like, this was definitely an on purpose thing that Hitchcock wanted in this story, which I think is great. And we will be discussing Strangers on Train, written by Patricia Highsmith, who, again, we talked about when we discussed the talented Mr. Ripley.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Which is on our Patreon wall if you're interested. So Mary Patricia Plangman was born in Fort Worth, Texas in 1921. She's written dozens and dozens of novels. She is known for thrillers. She is known for people with odd ideas for morality, borderline sociopaths. We were talking about her off the air. We've both been looking at interviews with her, and there's a documentary that I was watching just before we came on the air. She was a bisexual woman, mainly lesbian, but she did have affairs with men from time to time. As she liked to tell her lovers, I'm only doing that so people don't know I'm gay, which is, yeah. She had a very troubled relationship with her own mother. Her mother often told her she tried to have an abortion when she was pregnant with her. She comes to New York. She went to Barnard College. She goes to New York. And in Yaddo, it's a retreat that she enlists into. She joins. And that is the place where she, in 1948, where she comes with the idea for Strangers on a Train, which is about two people committing the perfect murder, and how would she make that happen. And it's an idea like almost seems, wow, of course, that's a great idea. But she really was the first one to come up with it. It's been used many, many times over the years, but she is the originator with it. And she speaks a lot about people with duality, people who keep secrets, people who aren't always truthful or forthright. This is one of those occasions where, as Margot said, like we've talked about Hitchcock and Highsmith before, people spend their entire academic professional careers even talking about these people. So, of course, this is just an overview that we're doing. But we encourage you, if you're interested, you should definitely, by the way, check out the book. The book is really great. We're going to be talking about that.
Yeah.
And she's just a fascinating writer. And she liked the book, but she said she was upset because her agent, when he sold it, this is her first, this is a debut novel, by the way, you should know. They sold it for $7,500, which is a lot of money in 1950, for sure. But they didn't tell them, unless, you know, it's Hitchcock and you could have gotten mm-hmm. much, much more. But Hitchcock liked to, you know, he's his own kind of little creepiness that he has about him. So,
yeah, you know, I mean,
she died, by the way, in 95. She lived to be 74 and she spent most of her time overseas towards the end.
And also avowed anti-Semite, mm-hmm. kind of racist.
Yes.
She's complicated lady. And but this book is so good. I'd never read it before. And I didn't realize that there would be so many differences. Of course, I've seen this movie. It's a classic and we'll talk about it in a little bit. But I didn't realize how the diversion that the movie took from the book. There's the big, big differences between the two of them. Although one thing that is not different between the two of them is this homosexual, homoerotic kind of subtext that's going on am I remembering correctly that was there somebody else who was interested in adapting this book before Hitchcock?
I don't recall.
I don't either. I don't know why that's kind of in the back of my mind.
There's different people he wanted to, that was going to play the guy role, but
yes.
they didn't work out. And that's why we have Farley Granger, who turned out to be a really great choice because he's also, he was sexually fluid, as he would, we would say now.
Yeah.
But
although not as conflicted, but we'll go, right. But anyway, the book is amazing. So let's talk about this book. The writing is so good.
Right.
I mean, say what you will about this woman. She can really write.
Oh, yeah.
it's super good.
I should say that she gave her entire fortune to Yaddo, the retreat.
That, writer's retreat.
Right. That she said that was like really what set her up for success as a writer later. It's the story of two men that meet on a train. And one of them is an architect named Guy Haines. These are the differences that we have already. Mm-hmm. And then we have Charles Anthony Bruno, who is the person that starts up the conversation. Yes.
Bruno is his last name in the book.
In the book. He's married to a woman who... And also the settings in the book are in Texas and the Southwest. So it's different in the movie. They're on this train to Texas, and he's basically trying to talk his wife into divorcing him because she's pregnant with another man's child.
Mm-hmm.
And she's dragging her feet, not really wanting to, because he's now dating. He hasn't made his big money yet, by the way. He's only like 27. He's still. He's like a bit like an apprentice, really, but he's ready for those projects. He's ready to make some money, make his mark on the world. And he's interested in a woman named Anne, who's a senator's daughter and comes from money, apparently, or comes from prestige. And Miriam, his wife, knows about this. And so Miriam wants to screw it to him. And that's, and we're, it's just like she's just that evil. She does no other.
Yeah. In the book, she has Miriam, the wife, has been unfaithful the entire time. Guy has walked in on her with another man. Most of the men that she gets involved with are also married. I think the man that she is pregnant by when the story opens is married. And the idea is that he's supposed to get a divorce so that she can be with him. And so he's thinking like, oh, well, this is perfect. And then I can finally get my divorce. And so, yeah, he is taking a train out to Texas where he's from. He will visit his
mother.
I can't remember if it's both his parents or just his mother, right?
Mm-hmm.
And also try to get this business of the divorce taken care of. But we'll talk about what happens when he gets there. So he's there. So this is where he's. He's an up and coming architect, not wealthy, but highly educated with a big future ahead of him. And he meets another young man on the train who is, I think he's drunk already, right?
Yeah.
The guy in the book, I mean, not Guy.
Bruno
in the book is extremely inebriated the entire time.
Yes.
Like he's never sober, basically. And that's a big problem. That's one of the reasons why he makes not the best choices. So he's super drunk in the middle of the day on this train and is, you know, like as you would if you found yourself in a train compartment with somebody with a drunk, you just go like, oh, yeah. Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah. That must be rough. And you just kind of go along to say whatever to not antagonize them. And this is kind of how their interaction starts out. We learn that Bruno is... I mean, what do you want to call him?
A mama's
playboy,
boy, a gadabout,
playboy, socialite.
Yeah.
He has no job. He's has plenty of money, but he feels that his father. Well, he says his money comes from his mother, but his father is the one that controls the money, which is probably how it would have been, and he really resents his father. for insisting that he like work.
Get a job, leave the house.
Do stuff, stop drinking.
Stop drinking all the time, yes.
What a jerk. And so he goes on and on about like, oh, my dad's such a, I mean, he's like this, he's too old to be having this kind of teenage, like my old man, but that's what he is.
He's such a meanie.
Yeah, he's such a meanie. He's always trying to act like he's so big. Truly, you know, and Guy is dealing with a drunk in the compartment. And so he's like, oh, yeah. I hear you. Oh, that must be hard. And eventually this drunk is going farther and farther and farther. And he's like, yeah, some days I just want to kill him. Just like you want to kill your wife, you know, like you want to kill somebody, like one does. And the guy's like,
he instantly can guess that Guy is not happily married, that he's going home to get a divorce, that he's been, yes that he, so he wants another life. He wants to. And so then this guy, once again, he's drunk, but he's also egotistical, and he just kind of jumps all over him and says, well, is she cheating on you? Did she cheat on you? Looks like she cheated on you. That would make me mad. Are you mad at her? And Guy's thinking like, yeah, and supposedly she's pregnant. It's not going to be mine. And so they get this. Bruno pushes on him like, you kill my dad, I'll kill Miriam. We'll both be great. And this is kismet. We were meant to meet each other. And Guy is sort of yesing him like, okay, sure, talk to you later. Guy leaves his book behind on the train compartment and he goes home. And then I forget, like, okay, so there's a difference between book and movie. Is she not actually pregnant in the book, or does she lose the baby?
She loses the baby. I think she was pregnant and she loses the baby. I don't think it's right. That she was, but she's not pregnant. And also the guy whose baby it was is not leaving his wife, and so therefore she is no longer amenable to getting a divorce. It's better for her to be married, you know, if there's more stigma to her being divorced than to be a married woman who is sleeping around with married men. And she's kind of nasty about it. Like, she's not a nice character when we meet her. Although Guy is loath to really badmouth her on the train, you know, we get his inner thoughts, and his inner thoughts are like, yeah, she's really messed up my life, and it would be so nice if she weren't around. And but in terms of what he's sharing, he's not really forthcoming about his feelings about her. But when we meet her, she is, in fact, a pretty nasty character.
Yeah.
And but she is still, although she is not pregnant, she is still involved with this guy who had gotten her pregnant. And or maybe he is single now. Maybe he is divorced and he doesn't want to marry her. Something like that. His name's Owen. And so they have this fight, and Guy's like, oh man, this is going to be a lot more complicated and it take a lot more time than I thought it was going to. So when he gets back to his mom's house, because this is in his hometown, so he's staying with his mother. He phones Anne or telegrams or whatever, and is like, yeah, listen, this isn't going to be so cut and dry like I thought it was going to be. I'm so sorry. And she's super understanding about it. And also, he has applied to be the architect of a very lucrative project in Florida. Is it in Florida? A hotel? It's a fancy hotel.
I think it is actually Florida. Yeah.
And so he's also nervous about that, you know, like, because this could be his big break as an architect and really make his name. I can't remember if Guy is still, I don't think he is. I think Guy is gone. And then Bruno comes into town and murders
Miriam. Guy's in Mexico and he's visiting family in Mexico, and he gets a from Bruno like, oh, hey, I got your book and I'm going to come by and drop it off for you. And Guy's like, oh, please don't, you know.
It's fine, just keep it.
Yeah, just keep it, please. But Bruno, he goes to Mexico and parties up in Mexico and he's with his family there. In the meantime, so Bruno comes to town and murders Miriam. And then Guy comes back, he hears about this, and then he calls his mother, he calls his girlfriend, and they're instantly like, this is really convenient for you, isn't it? You just came to town and then you just sneak away and she dies while you're gone. What is,
it looks real bad.
It looks really bad. And he's saying, I don't know. And they're like, well, where were you in Mexico and why were you there? And he can't explain everything away because he's talking to Anne the whole time. He doesn't want to drag Anne into this, but so he doesn't tell Anne anything. So she doesn't know, what's going on. He doesn't tell her until later.
He doesn't put it together right away that Bruno is the one who killed Miriam either, because he doesn't have any reason to believe. Like, this guy's a crazy drunk on a train. He's not necessarily, even if he's talking big about it, doesn't mean that, you just don't think somebody's going to haul off and do something like that. And he has no reason to believe that. Yeah, he just doesn't believe it at first. But then he quickly does, because right away, Bruno starts sending letters like, hey, I kept my end of the bargain. No, yes. Your turn to keep your end of the bargain. And hey, here's a map of my house and here's a key to my house. And this is what my dad's schedule is. And, haven't heard back from you. It's just like this barrage of letters and letters. Meanwhile, he's trying to get on with his life. He's trying to deal with the police because the police suspect him. They can't quite pin it on him, but they suspect him because it's suspicious.
It's very suspicious.
And he's trying to still get this job in Florida. He's trying to keep Anne from getting dragged into it. And he's also like, I have a literal homicidal maniac after me now.
Right.
I don't know what to do. And the longer I go without going to the police, the worse it looks for me. And yet I don't know how I can go to the police. I saw a clip. I don't know if this was from that documentary, the Loving Highsmith documentary.
Yes.
But there was a clip of Alison Bechdel. Is that how you pronounce her name?
Yeah, I think so.
And she was saying that when you read a Patricia Highsmith book, like, you start to believe that you could commit a murder because you can't help but be like, this could happen to me. I could run into some crazy person on a train and find myself in a mess like this. And what would I do?
Because the police aren't always on your side. They like to close cases. They're not into things that are technically difficult and complicated. They tend to want to just, the husband did it, great, let's bring him in.
Enough.
And he gets phone calls and letters.
Now he's getting phone calls and letters. And then even at some point, Bruno sends a letter to Anne. And it's like, oh, so you think Mr. Guy is so fabulous? Well, let me tell you something, he's not so great as you think he is. And if he doesn't to get back to me soon, I'll just let you know what kind of a man he really is. And she's like, what is this? It just keeps escalating. He sends Guy a gun. And he starts turning up. Where does he show up? Is it like somebody's wedding? Is it Guy's wedding? Guy and Anne get married and he shows up at the wedding. Yeah. And he tells people that he's an old friend of Guy's from architect school. And Guy's like, yeah, that's where I know this guy from. And so they keep up that little pretense. And Anne's like, why are you friends with this guy? You obviously don't like him. So what? You went to school with him. And he's like, oh, Bruno. And so in the book, unlike in the movie, and this is where we take a big departure, another big departure, Guy eventually gets this, Bruno gets so in his head, he thinks that the only way out of this is for me to kill his father.
Right. And then
so he does.
So he kills the father. And now they're both, he's figures.
Now they're both murderers.
They're both murderers. And they're not going to, the other one's not going to want to be turned into jail. So that's going to set them free. But it becomes even more of a cage because just Bruno doubles down. And it's like, we're besties now, aren't we? Aren't we the best of friends? Aren't we supposed to be together? Aren't we supposed to hang out all the time? Can I go on trips with you? Can I hang out with you? And Anne's like, who is this lunatic?
Why are we hanging out with this guy? And meanwhile, again, we are continually getting the inside of Guy's mind throughout the book. And Guy is wrestling. He's like, I cannot stand this guy. I want Bruno out of my life. And then, but he has these little flashes of, I love him. I can't cut him out of my life. And just out of nowhere, he has this like, I hate him. I love him. Oops.
Well, also, and Bruno goes to Mexico, or once he strangles Miriam, he goes looking for a woman, and he's like, I haven't wanted a woman in a long time. And then he pays a sex worker, and he just kind of quickly, like, he lets go of that energy that he has, and then he focuses right back on Guy. So that's part of the homoeroticism happening.
A lot, yeah. It's very repressed, but it is definitely there. And anyway, Guy's got Bruno as bestie for life now, and Bruno tags along on everything with Guy, and Guy is trying to think, like, I mean, I can't possibly pursue my career. He's going to wreck me. He's going to, like, I can't have people know that I have this guy in my life. And so he's rethinking everything. And meanwhile, this whole time, the police are still trying to pin his first wife's murder on him. Like, that never lets up.
Right.
Bruno, even before his father was killed, his father, who I guess must have had a brain in his head, had a private detective that he had hired to keep an eye on his son. Knowing his son, like, has not all the marbles. And so this private detective is really on Bruno when the father is killed. He's like, I know you had something to do with your dad's death. I don't know what it is, but I know there's something. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to find out what it is. And so he is just relentlessly pursuing Bruno. Well, Bruno is relentlessly pursuing Guy. And so it's only a matter of time before the detective is like, what is the deal with these two people? Like, why does he? And then he figures out, oh, Guy's got a murder in his recent past as well. And both of these guys were on a train together. And the detective is putting it all together and the walls are closing in. None of this is in the movie at all. Mm-hmm. So then Guy, who is really feeling the walls closing in on him, he and Anne and I think some other friends of theirs and Bruno, because Bruno's always there now.
Drunk, by the way, always drunk.
Yeah. Always so
slurring
drunk.
His words and just cornering people into conversations they don't want to have.
He's a millimeter away from blabbing about the murders at any time because he's always drunk. But anyway, they're on, was it a sailboat or somebody's yacht or
it's
something?
It's a
boat. It's a cruise, a 3-hour tour, and they're out on the water. And Bruno is drunk and belligerent, like he always is, and he falls into the water.
Right.
And Guy, something recently that we talked about. Guy is right in front of Guy. He falls in the water right in front of Guy. And Guy has this little moment of like, oh my gosh, I think if I just stand here and do nothing, all my problems will be solved.
Right.
But he can't, he jumps into the water. But then he has that again, like, but I love him. And he jumps into the water and he does everything he can to save Bruno, but it's too late. Bruno drowns. And Guy is now really, this really breaks him. You know, he's overcome. He does have guilt in the book. He does have guilt about Miriam's death and, some anyway, and he knows that the police, you know, could still easily pin everything on him.
Yeah. Time's running out. He kind of knows the jig is up. Yeah.
And he's like, okay, well, if the jig is up, then I'm going to go out with a clean conscience. I have to make things right with the guy that I robbed of precious Miriam, the horrible. And so, you know, the guy who was the man who
Owen.
Was the father of her child, Owen. So Guy goes back to goes back to Texas, tracks down this guy, Owen, and gets himself, you know, he's in like a flop house somewhere and he's in this room with Owen and he's like, okay, Owen, listen, you know, I don't know. You're probably wondering why I'm here. I have to get something off my chest because I've really wronged you. Like, I didn't do it on purpose, but something I did, I took something really precious away from you. What I did led to Miriam being taken away from you. And he's like, I don't care about that.
Yeah. Shrugs.
He does not care at all. Mm-mm. And Guy's like, no, I'm telling you, I am the reason that Miriam was murdered. He's like, yeah, I heard you. I don't care.
Couldn't care less.
And he's like, He's going on. He's like, don't you see? Don't you see? I'm guilty. Don't you see that I am the reason? I'm a murderer. And not only that, what I did led to the murder of this other perfect stranger who didn't do me any harm. And it's all because, and I'm so sorry. And he's like, why are you telling me this? I couldn't care less. And the more that Owen doesn't care, and he really does not care, the more Guy is like trying to make him care and confessing more and more and more and more. And then it turns out that the detective, Bruno's dad's detective, who's been following and putting all the pieces together, is right outside the door and has heard every single word. And he comes in, he's like, so let's go. Let's just go, Guy. It's time to go. And Guy's like, yeah.
Yeah, he's exhausted at this point.
He's done.
He's toast. So that's the end of the story. He knows he's going to be arrested. He's going to jail. There's no way around it. He committed murder and he hid everything. So that's the end of the story. It's great. It's a really fun read.
Super good.
I had the audiobook with a Bronson Pinchot, Balky.
Oh.
Does an amazing job. Really great job of this. Like I totally recommend, if you're looking for an audiobook, this is a really good one to get. He did a really excellent job. So this book comes out, and there's already people, you know, in publishing, they're sending things all the time to Hollywood hoping that they can sell something. And once again, we get our Alfred Hitchcock, who gives a nice offer, but obviously if they had known it was him, they would have asked for more money.
Yeah, he was at a point in his career where, he had come out to Hollywood. He had kind of gotten into a thing with David O. Selznick that they both really did not like each other very much, but they were in this business deal and it wasn't very good. And so to get out of it, I'm sorry for those of you who are Hitchcock scholars. I'm using like the bluntest instrument possible to tell this story. Sorry. But he forms his own production company. What's it called? Like Transatlantic Pictures. I think that's what it's called.
Yes. Yes. Transatlantic. Yes. Right,
with a friend back in Britain. Mm-hmm. And they do their first movie, Rope, which stars Farley Granger, is in color. Rope is one of those movies that people devote an entire college course to teaching about because it's extremely innovative. It has a homosexual couple as its main characters. Mm-hmm. The murder, they commit a murder together right at the very beginning of the movie. It was highly influenced by the case of Leopold and Loeb. So it was like ripped from the headlines,
yep,
kind of thing. And although it was also based on a book. And although it didn't do that great at the box office, at least in the U.S., it was banned in a lot of cities because the main characters were gay. But he now had a course that he wanted to stay on, you know, working where the way that he wanted to work on his own terms, Hitchcock did. I think in a lot of ways, I feel like in a lot of ways, this movie, Strangers on a Train, is a giant, like, middle finger to David O. Selznick.
I wouldn't be surprised, and I totally see why. They were all terrible. All the major...
By the way, David O. Selznick, who, I mean, regarded to be just a monstrous person.
Yes.
Accused of attempted rape by none other than Shirley Temple. He tried to rape Shirley Temple.
Yes.
According to her autobiography. This is the guy we're dealing with. And not long before Strangers on a Train, he had stolen the wife. Yeah, Jennifer Jones, who was married to...
Robert Walker.
Yes, who was married to Robert Walker. And this, like, really sent Robert Walker into a tailspin.
Yeah, he was...
Arguably ended his life very early.
He was devastated by this. They were very close, and then she leaves him, and they're still working on this movie when she's having an affair with the guy that runs the studio, and then they get married, and he's dumped, and he has other relationships, and I think he's even engaged, but he's still kind of... Farley Granger and him became very close friends when they worked on this movie. And Farley Granger said he confessed to him that he was just completely lost and so sad, and kind of used all those feelings and just put it into this character that he plays, which is amazing. And I think he dies just before the film comes out. I mean, it's...
Or right after. It's right around the release of the film that he dies.
And he's 32.
His son, Robert Walker Jr., had a very long and illustrious career. Mm-hmm. He was in everything in the 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s. I think he died, I can't remember if it was in the 2000s, but he had a very, very long career. His son looked just like him. Also very, very talented. But anyway, so we have some big departures in this film.
Should we play the trailer first?
Yeah, let's do.
Okay, so we're going to play the original trailer, 1951, Stranger on a Train.
I beg your pardon. Aren't you Guy Haines? My name is Bruno. Bruno Anthony. Want to hear one of my ideas for a perfect murder? Two fellows meet accidentally. No connection between them at all. Never saw each other before. Each one has somebody that he'd like to get rid of. So, they swap murders. Crisscross.
I may be old-fashioned, but I thought murder was against the law.
You think my theory's okay, Guy? I mean, you like it?
Sure, Bruno. Sure. Now, everything didn't go smoothly. She doesn't want the divorce.
But you sound so savage, Guy.
Sure, I sound savage. I feel savage. I'd like to break her neck. Now, who did you say this is?
Bruno, Guy. Bruno Anthony. Don't you remember? On the train.
Come on,
Miriam. Please, come on. Is your
name Miriam? Right here. How did you...
Guy, are you trying to tell me?
Why, you maniac!
But Guy, you wanted it. There seems to be no way of diplomatically breaking tragic news. It concerns your wife. She's been murdered. Miriam murdered?
She was strangled.
You're just as much in it as I am.
We planned it on the train. Crisscross.
How did you get him to do it?
He's a maniac. I met him on the train going to Medcalf. And now a lunatic wants me to kill his father. Bruno, I've decided to do what you want.
I still think it'd be wonderful to have a man love you so much he'd kill for you.
Well, then am I correct, Mr. Haines, in assuming that you have no intention of going ahead with our arrangement?
None whatsoever.
I don't like to be double-crossed. I have a murder on my conscience. But it's not my murder, Mr. Haines. It's yours. I'm not going to shoot you, Mr. Haines. I'll think of something better than that. Much better.
You better keep on your toes. Something funny's going on.
Guy Haines is taking chances I've never seen him take.
Excuse me, madam. I need your help. We're chasing a man.
Haines, hold it!
I'll just go through the cast really quick. We have Farley Granger as Guy. Ruth Roman plays Ann Morton. That's his fiance. Robert Walker is Bruno Anthony in this movie. We have Leo Carroll as Senator Morton. Patricia Hitchcock as Barbara Morton, who's great in this movie.
She's phenomenal.
Amazing.
I love her. I've never seen her that I didn't just adore her. I think she's so underrated.
Completely, because, you know, that's her dad who's directing the movie. Yeah. That's how she got in, but she still does the work. Casey Rogers is Miriam. Marion Lorne plays Mrs. Anthony. She's was in a million character roles in her life, and she's so great. And then Howard St. John is Captain Turley. Robert Gist is Detective Hennessy. Jonathan Hale as the father. This is all the action. There's many diversions that are made here, but they make Guy a tennis pro in this version.
So Hitchcock buys the property from Patricia Highsmith. This is, you know, a little bit late in the noir era, but he definitely wants it to have a noir feel, which the book definitely does. And so he tries to get, he wants Dashiell Hammett to write the screenplay. Dashiell Hammett's like, get out of here. And then he gets Raymond Chandler,
Mm-hmm.
That did not go well.
They hated each other.
They really hated each other.
Raymond Chandler had an ego too, and he gave Hitch, and Hitchcock ran a tight ship. He demanded all the credit. He demanded his crews would show up in suits and ties, and they had to be very, very professional. And he thought a lot of himself. He's Alfred Hitchcock. Why wouldn't he? But he had a very big ego, and so did Raymond Chandler. Chandler supposedly called him a fat F one time when Hitchcock was getting out of a car in front of a crew.
So that
relationship diminished. He just was like, yeah, I'm not going to work with this guy. And so that's when he hired Zenzi or Mond.
Well, that's his assistant. So then what happens is, he has his assistant. So he buys the property written by a woman. Then he has the screenplay written by his assistant, who's a woman, with his wife, who, of course, is also a woman. And that is the script that we get. And they his wife and his assistant, Chiochi Orman. Mm-hmm. Chenzi Orman. They are the ones who come up with the main devices of the film, of the glasses, the thing about the lighter. That is 100% them. And I gotta say, I think all of the I really like the choices that the movie makes.
I'm not mad at any of it. I'm glad he actually made some changes. I already know what the book feels like in my head when I read it. I already have an idea of it. So it's kind of fun. Well, what do you see? They actually filmed 1950, the U.S. Open, to get the Forest Hills. What's the tennis match? Uh-huh. That's the U.S. Open. They went,
I think so,
in Queens. They went the year before to get shots of the crowd, so it has that real look to it.
Yeah.
And then Robert Walker, I don't think plays drunk so much as he's just kind of just very sleazy,
He's very sleazy, and also we establish over the course of the movie, when you first see him, you're like, oh, he's an eccentric, rich guy, never had to work a day in his life. He's kind of a gadabout,
Dandy.
He's a little strange. Yeah, he was a bit of a dandy. He's very fancy. He's wearing, we see the shot, opening shot is the two men's shoes. And Bruno's shoes are quite fancy, spectator shoes. And whereas guys are a little more ordinary, and then there's the thing where they tap their tips of their toes together, he's not drunk. He is not messily drunk like the guy, the Bruno in the book is. As the movie progresses, start to understand, especially when we meet his mom, who is so Aunt Clara from Bewitched.
Yes. She's doing she's giving him a manicure in the home. I mean, it's...
Yeah.
I do wish you'd keep your hands quiet. You're so restless lately.
I like them to look just right.
Did I file them too short?
Oh, no, Mother. Just fine. Thanks.
What's the matter?
Oh, I'm all right. Don't worry about me.
But you look so pale, dear. Are you out of vitamins?
I took a bottle yesterday, Ma. A whole fifth.
Oh, but you have that look, dear. I always can tell. Now, you haven't been doing anything foolish. Mm. Well, I do hope you've forgotten all about that silly little plan of yours.
Which one?
About blowing up the White House.
Oh, Ma, I was only fooling. Besides, what would the president say?
You're a naughty boy, Bruno. Well, you can always make me laugh. Now get shaved before your father gets home.
I'm sick and tired of bowing and scraping to the king.
No. Now let's not lose control. Come see my painting. Bruno, I do wish you'd take a painting. Such a soothing pastime.
Ha 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 Oh, Mother, you're wonderful. That's the old boy, all right. That's Father.
She's giving him a manicure, and she's saying to him, oh, honey, how are you? Did you have a good trip? Because he talks, going back just a wee bit, they're talking to each other on the train. He immediately just busts his boundaries, like sits right next to him, starts this conversation, continues the conversation. He has a tie tab or tie thing that says Bruno on it. He's fancy. And then they're immediately having lunch together in a private car. And he's just really like, oh, I read the society papers. You're dating Anne, aren't you? And that's, you know, don't you have a wife back home?
But you want a divorce, huh?
Wouldn't that be convenient for you to get a divorce from her? And he's like, looking at him like, how do you know this stuff about me? But he knows he's famous. That's the thing that makes it different. His guy is somebody that people, if you're into tennis, you know exactly who he is. And the hoity-toity people usually are into tennis. It's like the tennis whites and everything. The crowd looks like you would see it now, basically, in the audience. But they, so they get off the train, and he literally just says, sure. I'll murder, and you better, bye. And then the next scene is Bruno sort of, I don't know if he's going to go through with it, and he's all worried, and at the same time, his mother's giving him a manicure. That's like what we see, and then she's fussing over him.
She's fussing over him, and she's like, I mean, I do hope you would give up this idea of blowing up the White House. Just like a casual conversation.
He's like a little Ted Kaczynski.
And he was like, oh, that. So then you're like, what, who are these people? Like, that's his mom. Okay. What kind of a person gets raised by a lady like that?
And she seems really sweet, but just daffy. But then she says, oh, you want to look at my painting? I did a painting of your father. And you look at the painting and it's garish and scary. And so she's not all together.
Mm-mm.
And then we have Guy in here. He goes to meet Miriam. And Miriam is pregnant. And she meets him and says, yeah, I'm pregnant, but I'm going to stay married to you anyway. Because I realize now, like, you're going to make a lot of money. And you've got...
Yeah.
Like, she can get more money out of him. Yeah, you're famous now. Yeah. So he gives her, like, $100 and then she just takes and she goes, no, I want more. There's going to be, I'm going to be your wife. You're going to make this really difficult for you. And so he's caught screaming at her, like, how can you do this to me? You ruined my life. So everybody kind of hears this argument.
Yeah.
He leaves.
And sees them arguing.
And sees them. And he's grabbed her arm and he's, like, super furious because she's, mm-hmm. and they're in this room where there's no sound, it's soundproof, so people can look in, but they can't hear them. And she's just saying to him, like, nope, you're not, I don't care what you want. I'm gonna ruin your life. I don't care. This mm-hmm. is my ticket. My pregnancy is my ticket, even though it's not you're not the father. He's furious, of course. They have an argument, and then Bruno starts following Miriam, and Miriam
Wait. So this is, again, none of this is in the book at all. So he has this argument in front of everybody. They can see it, but they can't hear it. They can't hear that she's being
blackmailing
really
him.
Cruel and blackmailing him.
Yeah.
It just looks like he's beating up on his wife. He storms out. He goes and calls Anne to tell her, listen, this is going to be harder than I thought. He says to Anne on the phone, I'm so mad. I want to kill her. She's like, what? He's like, I said, I want to kill her.
He's right at the train station.
I want to strangle her with my bare hands. These two hands. I'm going to wrap them around her neck. Like, he's like, really?
Because the train's going by. And so she's trying to, instead of waiting for the train to go by and whisper, he's screaming
yelling
at the top because he's so mad. He's so upset because she's ruining everything for him. And then we have Bruno start following Miriam. And so Miriam starts the night. Two dates.
Which I think that is in the book, that she's out with two men when Bruno is following her. I seem to remember that she's out with two men. She's got two dates. We don't know if one of them is the father of her child. No, it's never brought up. Could be, could not be.
She,
we just don't know.
She goes to this amusement park. They go to an amusement mm-hmm. park, and Robert is following them. I'm sorry, Bruno is following them. And he's just kind of making eye contact with her from a distance. And she makes eye contact back with him.
She's flirting with him. He's extremely well-dressed. We've already established that money and status are important to her. She notices this very fancy man who seems to not be able to take his eyes off of her.
So, right.
Who's following her around. And she's like, woohoo, maybe I'm going to ditch my two dates. And we have this really amazing sequence where he's following her throughout the amusement park. They go through the tunnel of love and he's in the boat behind Miriam and her two dates, who start fighting over her. Miriam kind of wanders off and leaves them to fight over her. And they are now in this, like, I guess where people go to make out.
Yeah. Lover's lane kind of thing.
Kind of thing. Yeah. And it's dark. She's kind of just wandering about, and Bruno is there waiting for her. And he, with Guy's lighter, lights the lighter in her face, illuminating her glasses. Mm-hmm. And he says, isn't your name Miriam? And she's still flirting with him. She's like, yeah, hell yeah, how'd you know? And he immediately throws it, like, he's like, that's all I need to hear.
That's a yes. Yeah. That's a confirmation.
Is your name Miriam?
Why, yes. How did you...
Then there's the famous, famous shot of him strangling her, reflected in her glasses. Which is amazing.
It looks incredible. It looks
really cool.
It still really holds up. And it's so funny, like Bosley Crowther, is that his name? New York Times, sort of like, well, this is just another Hitchcock mystery, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, what are you not seeing? You don't get with critics sometimes. But anyway, so she's dead.
She's dead. And then we see Bruno picks up her glasses and the guy's lighter, and he pockets them, and then he wanders off. And now he's going to, so now we are just completely in movie land. Mm-hmm. Nothing related to the book is happening from here on out. So he goes straight to Guy and is like, because I care about you, I work fast. And, you know, just in case you're wondering if I really got the job done, here's your glasses. That guy's like,
Guy's outside of his home in Washington, D.C. And this guy's across the street, middle of the night, like, sees him. And they're talking, and then he has to now take a phone call from Anne going, oh, my God, have you heard the news? They found Miriam. She's been murdered. So he's like,
He's got to act surprised. What?
Yeah. So he does tell Anne, like, he says to Anne, he was on a train at the same time that the murder happens. And he's in a train mm-hmm. car with another person who's visibly drunk. And they talk a little bit. So he's like, oh, I was on a train and there's this guy with me on the train car. So he'll be my alibi. But when they bring the guy in, he's sober now and he doesn't remember anything. Mm-mm. So they're like,
he can't. It's useless.
Yeah, and the tickets would just say just to New York. It wouldn't have said, you know, what date or time or anything. So,
right.
So there's no way to establish that he did actually get on that particular train. So they don't mm-hmm. have proof that he's guilty, but he also doesn't have proof that he's innocent. So he's sort of in this mm-hmm. state. So they have, he's being tailed by a detective for his protection. And then they talk about, and then Bruno says to the family, there's this guy and he's like a little, he's nuts. He's following me. He's making me very nervous. I think he's the one that did this. He's obsessed with me. Like, I don't know what's going on. So the family wants to protect him, but they also don't.
Yes,
they don't,
Anne's family.
And his family. So the youngest is Patricia. She's the younger sister and she also wears glasses and strongly resembles Miriam. It's amazing. So Guy has this match in Queens and he's looking up in the okay. crowd and the crowd is just, they're staring back and forth looking at a tennis match and Robert Walker's just staring at him, just chilling.
Here is where Alma Hitchcock and Chenzi, what's your last name?
Ormond.
This is where it is a stroke of genius because I'm pretty sure that this is their idea. You know, you make him a tennis guy, you make him a tennis star. So we have to have these sequences where he's playing a tennis match. Is there a more suspenseful sport than a tennis match where it's like bunk, bunk, bunk,
no
and
kidding.
The audience is looking back and forth and back and forth, all except for the one creepy guy that's in the middle of the stands. It's so brilliant.
Je parle vous la
connaissez
pas. This is Mr. Anthony, a friend of Monsieur and Madame Darville. Guy Haines.
I've been a fan of yours for a long time, Mr. Haines. In fact, I follow everything you do.
Mr. Anthony has been telling us some charming stories. Very funny. Est-ce que vous connaissez l'histoire du croque-mort?
Oui, je la connais.
Oui, oh,
non. Oh, il les connaît. Écoute, dis-lui dans l'histoire des trois petits chiens sur le boulot.
Non,
oh, mais oui.
Non, j'aimerais mieux lui dire l'autre chose. Vous savez ce qu'on avait raconté?
Non.
Racontons une histoire qui se passe au fait.
Oh, oui, avec
I've just been talking to your shadow. Guy, did you know Mr. Hennessy helped crack that axe murder I was reading about? You know, the one where the body was cut up and hidden in the butcher shop. He was locked in the icebox with the left leg for 6 hours.
Oh, Babs, he pulls those things out of his hat.
Who's the interesting-looking Frenchman with the Darvilles?
His name's Anthony. He's not French.
Bonjour, madame, monsieur. How are you?
Delightful to see you, Miss Barbara. How sweet you look.
I hope you aren't forgetting our little party on Thursday, madame.
We're planning on it.
But of course.
This is my sister Barbara. Barbara, this is Mr. Anthony.
How do you do?
I just want to say one little thing about, I think, I know that Hitchcock wanted, who was it that he wanted in this role? Was it Cary Grant or something?
Not Cary Grant, but was somebody like very, I'd say, masculine, sort of a tough guy.
Yeah, and I think Farley Granger's so good
in
this. Oh, no,
it's so much better.
It's a wonderful performance. So Farley Granger is one of the men in, one of the male leads in Rope, which is Hitchcock's previous film. Mm-hmm. Farley Granger tells a story that, first of all, when he was hired onto the film, he fell in love with the screenwriter, Arthur Lawrence, who we talked about when we talked about Birdcage, because Arthur Lawrence was one of the writers of La Cage aux Folles.
Right.
But at the time, you know, this is right after the war. You certainly could not be out. It was illegal. I mean, it was, let alone like all the dangers to your career and whatnot. Farley Granger was always like really comfortable with who he was.
He said he was bisexual. You know, he always
kind
of just shrugged his shoulders. He didn't try to hide it.
And so he got it. You know, he was in this relationship with Arthur Lawrence. They were living together. Arthur Lawrence was the one that was a little bit more scared, a little more, you know, and there was plenty of reason to be scared.
Of course.
later on, of course, he's able to come out and, you know, he has this wonderful, he has a very long relationship. Like 50 years he has a partner for, you know, later on in life. But at this point, he's very young. He's in an industry that is extremely not gay friendly, in a country that is extremely not gay friendly. And so it's very, very difficult. But Farley Granger tells the story that, you know, it's early on in production. And he's in this relationship. He's definitely fallen in love with Arthur Lawrence. I think that's who it is, right? Hitchcock invites this to Farley Granger, like, hey, you know, come on over for dinner. We're having everybody over for dinner. And he's like, okay, great. He thinks like, oh, the entire cast and crew, or, you know, at least the cast is coming. Jimmy Stewart's in this movie, and he was definitely not gay. And so Farley Granger and Arthur Lawrence make sure that they come in separate cars at separate times. You know, they go to all the, you would have to go to all this trouble to try to hide the, and they show up at the house and it's just Alma and Alfred Hitchcock. It was just a dinner for two couples. And he said that they just treated them as though it was just, they were just having another couple that they were having dinner with. And Alfred Hitchcock never had anything remotely, you know, didn't comment on it, had nothing negative to say about homosexuals at all in his presence, was absolutely wonderful about it, and made him feel, therefore made him feel very safe, made him feel very safe on that set.
Yeah, the woman didn't feel safe was the one who played Bruno's mother. She was also, Alfred Hitchcock, because in the book, they describe Bruno's mother as, she's described as beautiful. She's like this high society babe sort of thing. You know, a cougarish kind of lady, like middle-aged, but hot.
Married to sort of a gigolo kind of a relationship,
And the woman he gets is not that. But she's great. But Alfred Hitchcock, you know, could be, he said that he finds one person to kind of pick on or put his aggressions on. And so, unfortunately, she was the one. But she had been in the business for a while, so she kind of just shrugged it off and just dealt with it. But yeah, he was very nice to him. And it was a great part for him. And yes, Farley Granger was pretty out. I mean, there's the movie called The Celluloid Closet, which was 1999, was like, it blew my mind when I saw it then. And to watch it now, it's very quaint.
I saw it in the movie theater. I know, it's very tame now.
I look at it, I'm like, oh God, yeah, I missed a lot of things the first time I saw them.
But he does, it's such a good performance. And he does, like, the subtlety of his performance in dealing, because again, you don't have a Bruno who's in the book. Guy, like I said, he will have these flashes of like, I love this man, but he never says anything like that out loud or never indicates that. And Bruno in the book is always inebriated. He is never sober. Whereas in the movie, this man is always 100%. He is 100% sober. He just doesn't have a really firm grip on reality. And yet, you know, Guy's character, Farley Granger's performance of this character, like, you kind of wonder, like, what is his deal? Because he's not really broken up about his wife being murdered. Even though we've established that she's a terrible person, he's not really that guilt-ridden about it.
No, I mean, it relieved a problem for him, but he also, like, just doesn't like the stink of it on him.
He's more concerned about, is this going to touch the reputation of my potential future father-in-law and therefore ruin my future, is sort of what you are getting. Why does a tennis player want to go into government? But he does. You know, we've established he definitely wants to work for Anne's father. Like, that's clear. And yet, you know, that doesn't make any sense. Like, why would it? He's a tennis player.
Well, nowadays, you know, we have reality show people that.
Yeah.
Yes. But you know, it's very strange. And you do wonder about it. And you get the impression, I guess what I'm saying is, he's not so much worried that, like, he's going to lose Anne. Because he loves her so much. He's not really that worried about that. He's more worried about wrecking the thing with her dad.
Anne isn't given that much to do in the movie.
No.
In the book, she's a little bit more, you can kind of see more of a love match there, maybe. Or she's, I mean, in the movie, I mean, she's beautiful, by the way. The woman is, yeah, is gorgeous. Oh, she,
no question
those,
about
those
it.
Outfits,
she's
those
very
gowns.
Good.
Yeah.
But she's not given that much to do. You're right.
No. And so she's like, you know, she's there to kind of help move the pieces around, but it's really more about the younger, the sister and the father. And it's really about Bruno and Guy trying to outsmart each other, and Bruno's mm-hmm. sort of following him everywhere, and he now has his lighter. He has like all these things that he can say that, you know, can make Guy make, you know, Guy complicit. You know, uh-huh. So anyway, he's crying. He does give a map and a key and a very distinct drawing to like turn this corner, then turn that mm-hmm. corner, and then. To kill the father. So Guy shows up. He's like, I gotta do it. Shows up at the house. And of course, Bruno doesn't tell him there's a dog like at the top of the stairs, like barking. But he goes into there. And then he's in the movie. The difference is that Guy is going to tell the father, look, your son's nuts. This guy gave me a gun. He wants to get you killed. I want to warn you because you need to protect yourself, blah, blah, blah. And who should be in the bed? But Bruno in a full suit.
In a tuxedo.
In a tuxedo.
As one does.
Exactly. And he's like, what do you think you're doing, huh? I'm on to you, and you can't get away from me, and we're always going to be, you know, together. We're always going to be implicit with each other. So he doesn't. So Bruno is like, what do I do? What do I do? He has a big match. He has a big tennis match. And Bruno goes from D.C. to New York. I mean, it goes like really quickly to Queens to meet him. It's this big tennis match. Guy wins, and Bruno loses the. At one point, he loses the lighter.
The lighter, the one piece of evidence he has to tie
right.
Guy to the murder.
And mm-hmm. he has to put his hand. And there's a lot of times where people are reaching like for something, and it's almost there, and you don't know if they're going to get it or not. But he does get it. But he and Guy are they're just says. Get to the end, so they're speeding up and they're following each other. They wind up back at the carousel. They wind up back at the carnival, the
amusement park.
The amusement mm-hmm. park. Thank you. And they're on.
They got the police following them now.
The police are now. And we didn't say before, but the amusement park people thought there was something up with Robert Walker, because why is this fancy pants guy here? Right.
This, right.
They're circus people. They're just the amusement people. They're like, this guy doesn't belong. This is there's something odd about
yeah,
him.
Yeah, so they notice
something
him.
Is up. Yeah, so they notice when yeah. he comes back. So he comes back and Guy comes back and they're on this carousel and there's a kid on the carousel and the carousel's going super fast.
Can we just say
how is nobody throwing up? By the way,
I know nobody's throwing up.
I would be
so Guy knows that Bruno has this lighter. And that Bruno is on his way to plant the lighter at the scene of the crime to, because Bruno's mad about Guy trying to like foil his murder plans. So Bruno is going back to the amusement park to plant the lighter to make it point the finger at Guy. So Guy is now at the amusement park. He sees Bruno there. He's like, I can't, he's going to fight this guy. The police are behind both of them. And the carny says to the police officer, like, there's the murderer. And they're like, yeah, we know. And so the police blindly shoot into the crowded carnival with the merry-go-round. And they completely miss the two men they're trying to shoot and kill who? The merry-go-round operator. So now Guy and the two men are on the merry-go-round. They're fighting. The merry-go-round is somehow that's a setting on a merry-go-round is 45 miles an hour.
Yeah, exactly. It's like centrifugal force. It's just going to shoot up into the sky any second. It's just going so fast.
Amazing.
It's pretty great. There's one woman that's on holding for her life, for dear life,
the
on one of the horses.
Man.
Yeah. Underneath, trying to unplug it.
It's amazing. It is a jaw-dropping
And there's
stunt.
A little kid who's like, oh, this is fun. And his mother's screaming like, that's my son. Help my son. Yeah. And so Farley Granger is not only fighting Bruno, but he's actually saving the kid. But they are fighting. And then they do pull the plug.
So this old carny is like, I'll take care of this.
No teeth.
no teeth. He's crawling underneath the speeding. He's crawling underneath the speeding carousel. I mean, the suspense is like building and building and building. And yeah, he makes it into the center of the carousel. He basically like essentially pulls the plug on the thing. And this thing that has been going, as I say, like 45 miles an hour, just comes to a complete halt. Well, it's, you know, people go flying all over the place. It is spectacular effect.
Yeah.
The whole, like, the carousel just up at a 45 degree angle and people are screaming and rushing. Bruno is pinned under a merry-go-round horse, I think. He's not going to make it. And to the last, he's like, Guy was the murderer. I promise you, just believe me because I'm the one who's dying. He's truly the murderer. He's the guy. He's the guy. And
Guy's like, come on. Come on, man. You're about to meet your baker. Like, let's come on. Yeah. But he's not going to give up. But the old carnies are saying, no.
The carnies were the ones like, no, this is the guy that was walking away from the murder scene. I saw that guy, the dead guy now. He is definitely the murderer. This guy either here, I've never seen it before in my life. And that's who ultimately saves.
Yes.
Farley Granger.
Right.
Who's now free to have his loveless marriage with the senator's daughter.
With the
his politics career.
Yeah. So in the end, they're on a train going someplace, and the person, it's a priest, I believe, he has the collar.
Yeah.
Sitting across to them and says, oh, hey, aren't you Guy, whatever, the famous tennis player? And they just look at each other, they leave. They're like, no, we're not, we don't do this. And that's the end of the movie. It's a very Hitchcockian way to end it, but
yeah,
it does very well at the box office. It's a big, and I get it. There's not that many Oscar nominations, but it's considered a classic. It's studied.
Mm-hmm.
It's
not a long film either. I mean, it is a roller coaster ride. It goes super fast. Things happen one after another.
Surprise! I'm like, oh my God, we're already back at the carousel. Yeah. I was kind of shocked about
That's why the that, especially that last, the tennis sequence is so suspenseful, because we've been going and going and going at such this clip, and now we're stopping for a tennis match. It feels like, to the audience, you know, you're like, we're going to watch tennis now? Okay.
And like you said, that's an agonizing sport to watch, I think. It really makes me I had a roommate
tense.
That was totally into tennis, and I couldn't take it. Like, you're just like, poof. Poo. Yay!
Yeah.
Poo.
Yeah.
Like, I can.
It's so good. I can see the homoerotic subtext isn't as blatant.
No.
Isn't as it is in Rope. All of the performances are so, so good. Yeah, I mean, I just think it's absolutely brilliant. It's such a great movie. It's pretty perfect, and I really loved the book. But I must say, I think that the choices, like the whole thing about the glasses, again, the whole idea of making him a tennis star, so that we do have to have this very, very suspenseful, much more than if he was like an architect, as he is in the book. All of those kinds of choices, I think, work so well for the movie. The fact that I don't think it's an amusement park in the book either, where Miriam is killed.
No, that's something they came up with, and I think they filmed that in California, right? That's
I think so.
It's like one of those places they film a lot of those. Yeah,
yeah.
Great music, by the way.
Great music,
Dimitri Tomkin.
Chumkin, yeah.
Chumkin. Mm-hmm. I thought it was fabulous, and it just was put into the Library of Congress for being culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant in 2021.
What's Alfred Hitchcock's daughter's name? Patricia.
Patricia.
She is so good in this movie. She's the baby sister of Anne, and she is kind of the audience's surrogate in the movie, and she's really smart and knows what's up and is in on helping them catch Bruno.
In a second that there's something wrong with the guy.
She instantly sees him for what he is. And it's just a great performance. Such a good performance. So much fun.
And Farley Granger is also
I always love her.
Beautiful. He's He's gorgeous.
Gorgeous.
Oh, my God.
He is a good-looking man. Yeah. It's great. It's great. And you believe him as an athlete. I love
absolutely.
It. I just love the whole thing. It's so good. I love it, love it, love it. Yeah, definitely read it. This is unlike last week's. Like, this is a book that if you love this movie, it will enhance your love of the movie to read the book. Is a super good book.
She's a fantastic writer. She really is. Great ideas, great dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, very good dialogue. Yeah, agreed. So book or movie?
I'm going to pick the movie. Just...
I am too.
I know. I'm glad I listened to it, though. I really like this book. I trust me, but I'm going to just give it a bit more. I always just love watching this movie. I always just get caught into it.
It's
I love the
so
performances.
Good.
I love everything about it. Yeah.
I will say too that I must give the edge to the movie. The movie is so good. But one of the things that's really cool about the book is has that same kind of pace mm-hmm. that the movie has too. Like, it's very action packed. Right away, it starts out, you know, this kind of leisurely thing on the train, but then it really takes off and you gotta hang on, or you're gonna miss like really important stuff. It's super good. It's very tense. It's very suspenseful. And it's an interesting story with where they both commit murders.
Mm-hmm.
But they have very different feelings about those murders.
They do.
It's really, yeah, I really liked the book very much. It was really fun to read that book. But I must give an edge to the movie.
Yeah. Just a slight edge.
A little one.
Yeah. Great. All right, everyone. So but please send us your suggestions. And once again, that's the Facebook group, Book VS Movie Podcast Group. That's what you attach. You type in for Facebook. That's also how you find us wherever you get your podcasts. Be sure to subscribe. Join the Patreon if you feel like it. Please leave us a review if you feel generous enough to do that. We'd really appreciate it. Or just tell a friend about the show. Our email, once again, is bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com. And Margo, where can they find you?
You can find me online at coloniabook.com, and all of my social media callouts are at She's Not Your Mama. And where can they find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Brooklyn Margo. My site is Brooklyn Fit Chick. My Instagram is Brooklyn Fit Chick. And I'm on TikTok at Margo Donahue. And I put some clips up there from Stranger on a Train. So you need to check that out if you use the TikTok, as I call it. All right, everyone. Thank you so much for checking in with us. We'll be back soon with a new episode. Thank you so much for listening to the Book Versus Movie podcast. We are a part of the Frolic Podcast Network. You can find more podcasts you will love at frolic.media/podcasts. We follow the hashtags LadyPodSquad and PodernFamily. If you want to support the show, you can go to our Patreon page. Go to Patreon and look for Book Versus Movie Podcast. We have a basic Facebook page, but we also have a private Facebook group. Go to Facebook and type in Book VS Movie Podcast Group if you want to join that. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Book Versus Movie. Spell all those words out. If you'd like to send us an email, it's Book Versus Movie Podcast. Spell that all out at gmail.com. You can follow Margo D at Brooklyn Fit Chick on social media and Margo P at She's Nacho Mama. Thanks so much again for checking out our show, and we'll be back soon with a new episode.